Ere the days of the great Roman Empire, in the rule of the Triumvirate, Cleopatra, the famous Egyptian queen, was Mark Antony's regular date. She'd long dumped her old boyfriend Caesar. He'd been stabbed by a cruel Roman brute, who in turn met his end at Philippi, when Octavius put in the boot. In the spring of B.C. 37, she was cruising her barge up the Nile, with a cargo of best local handbags, made of best local crocodiles. When she saw a handsome young Roman hitching a lift with his thumb, she said, "Tell me how far you are going, and with me on my barge you may come." "I was out on a jaunt for the weekend," says he, "exploring the sights of the Nile, pondering who built the pyramids and the Sphinx's inscrutable smile. I don't really care where I go now, I've time on my hands I can spend. Why don't we go back to your place, and we'll both have a dirty weekend? First tell me your name, sir," said Cleo, adopting a more regal tone. "My name is Queen Cleopatra, you know, and I usually sit on a throne. Most of the girls call me Big Boy," said Mark Antony, cocky as hell. Replied she, "Men I know call me Madam, but Your Highness will do just as well. If Rome finds out what you've been up to, I'm sure that they won't be amused. They'll say you've behaved without honour, your position's been grossly abused. But you're fit, so I'll offer my honour to you, and 'cause she was a bit of alright, back at her palace he honoured her offer. It was honour and offer all night." They got up to all sorts of mischief in her bed with its sheets made of silk, and then did the whole thing again for a laugh, while immersed in a bath full of milk. They dressed up in each other's clothing, and peculiar games they did play. She'd roll herself in a carpet, and here'd be her felt underlay. One of her young serving maidens went and got in the family way. Antony, known as a bit of a lad, all her courtiers thought was to blame. But it really was one of the eunuchs, a spotty and garrulous yob, who, questioned on why he had done it, just said, "I'm just not cut out for the job." Well, Cleopatra had six sexy handmaids, but for none of them Antony felt. For Cleo had wisely demanded that he wear the chastity belt. Antony liked kinky clothing, PVC, rubber and plastic. And whenever he saw Cleopatra bend over, he'd twang her knicker elastic. Folk in Rome started getting stroppy, and Octavius said war there must be. And Antony, thinking he'd win it with ease, at Actium did battle by sea. He lost and then took his own life, all for the sake of his mall. But Mattel did quite well in the toy shops from sales of the Actium and all. The end came when Cleo got migraine. Oh, she had such a pain in her head. So she sent out a maid for an aspirin. Daft wench brought back an asp instead. But clasping the snake to her bosom, calling Antony's name, Cleo died. The soldier's pole fell, Terrene moon was eclipsed, and the news tablets read suicide. No custom staled Cleo's variety. In life and in death, 'twas the same. And now, in the fields of Elysium, they say she and Antony still play their games. Hand in hand, there walk the lovers, the greatest the world's ever known. One wears a low-cut and sexy black shroud, and the one in the toga's the queen.